What's up, y'all? It's Pastor Jay, and welcome to WorldShakers TV. This message that you're about to watch is a super special message to me. It's the first time I'm actually able to openly share, you know, what it is that kept me and strengthened me through the transition of my father to heaven in the summer of 2018. And so I know a lot of times when the transition of a loved one happens, you know, we have a lot of questions trying to figure out, you know, why, you know, what's going on, like how did it happen? And we got so many questions that a lot of times we're not going to be able to answer. And so we need to be able to find rest and assurance in not knowing. And so this message here, it helped me, and it's the thing that has, you know, kept me and sustained me and strengthened me and grown me and built me, you know, over the past year and a half. And, you know, I don't hope or pray that this message helps you. Like, I know it will. Like, it's so potent, it's so real, it's so clear to where you can really associate this or connect this with any area of your life. Any kind of situation that happens, you can connect this with it, and you'll be able to take the necessary steps to be better, to build better. And so I'm thankful for this message. It'll be really good. There's some things that were said during this message that during the time, you know, just didn't make sense, but now they do. They make a lot of sense. And so you watch it and you check it out, and you see if you can pick up what it is. Check it out.
There are a lot of people who are still incredibly hurting. And whenever you're in a place of extreme hurt, you're in a place of extreme stagnation.
Yes, sir.
Because when you don't address the hurt, or you don't allow God to infiltrate where you're hurt, then you are going to be stuck in a place and not being able to move or progress. And so thank you, Holy Spirit. And so this morning, I want to put my life on display. And by putting my life on display, I want to put on the life of Jesus on display. Because during the transition, there's nothing that I could have done in my humanistic ability to be able to be standing in front of you for as long as I've been standing in front of you. For as soon as I was able to stand in front of you. And so, because what the Holy Spirit wants to do this morning is, so it don't matter, you know, what trauma that you've gone through, it don't matter, you know, what loved one is going home on to be with God, whatever situation in your life seems like a tragedy, you will be able to understand your position in the midst.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And so, you know, me and Dr. Phil had one of the most beautiful, we still have one of the most beautiful relationships ever known to man. Yeah. But in understanding, and so now, in following him, I had the Holy Spirit engrafted me with a great revelation on sonship. And so he was able to teach me, you know, how to follow, how to be a son. And so, and it's funny because he gave me that revelation with, you know, one of the greatest pattern sons, you know, maybe secondary to Jesus ever to live on the face of the earth. And so in the relationship, we move from servant to son to friend.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Because, you know, there were things that as a man, you don't just want to share with anybody. And so there were things that, you know, he could share with First Lady, things that he couldn't share with First Lady. There's things that he could share with Dr. Walker, there's things that he couldn't share with Dr. Walker. And so everything in the midst and in between, he shared them with me. And so I could tell the progression, because you can see how you go from being given instruction on a constant basis to being enlisted to consult with. And so then we got to the point to where he'd be asking me, you know, what do you think about this? What do you think we should do? Because, you know, one of the most gratifying things as a man or as a son is growing up and getting the acceptance of your father. And so once you get to that point, it's like, you know, because now it's not a situation to where, because Jesus said this. He said, I don't call you servants. I call you friends. Because there's nothing that the Father wants to do that I don't share with you. And so we got to the point to where whenever something like we just share together. And so that's why, you know, I have been able to, it's one of the reasons why I've been able to walk the way that I have, because I was able to eavesdrop on so many conversations I was able to be imparted in, even when I didn't want to be imparted in. Even when I had an attitude or I was in the mood or I just, you know, I feel like, here you go again, he still kept pouring. And so many of y'all see me wear this ring, because this is a ring that he gave me a few months before he transitioned. And you know, I never wore this ring while he was here on this earth. I always kept it with me. But if you know anything about the passing of a ring, when a father passes a son a ring, it's a passing of authority. It's a passing of what I have on my life, I'm passing it on to you. Because now we see in the story of the prodigal son, well, the first thing that father did was he put a ring on that boy's finger. Because I need you to know that all that I have is yours. Everything that God has given to me belongs to you. But I never wore this ring until after the transition. And so that's why one of the things that helped me so much was because when things happen in life, they can be traumatic, and sorrow could come in, and we can feel sorry for ourselves. And that's one thing that he helped me with, because when things happen in life, especially with the transition of a loved one, we cannot make it a selfish thing. We cannot make it about us. Because most times when people are hurting, they're hurting for them. They're not hurting for the person that's going on home to be with the Lord. They're hurting for themselves. Yes, whether it's something that I didn't get a chance to do, I didn't. And so that's why I also have a problem. And I thank the Holy Spirit for helping me in this area, because when I see people, you know, weeping and talking about how much they wish they could talk to them and say this, I'll be like, you a lie. Because while he was here on this earth, you didn't take it here to anything that he was saying to you. That's why God said, no, don't call no man your father unless you're willing to listen to him.
Yeah.
So they got people who was calling him father but was actually bastards. Because he was never their father, because they never listened and inclined their ears to what he was saying. He's always trying to bring everybody to a new level of living. Some people thought he was trying to control them and tell them what to do, but he's only trying to push you into the destiny that God got for you. And so, because when things happen, and we can look, you can look at Matthew 26. I got a bunch of things to say, and I hope I can get to them all. But we look at Matthew 26. Let's go there real quick. Matthew 26. Give me verse 36. Because anything in life that happens, we got to look at the life of Jesus. Then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane. And saith unto the disciples, sit ye here, while I go and pray yonder.
Yes.
And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. So this Jesus here. So, because what I think this passage shows us about him is it shows us his human side. Because a lot of people like to think of Jesus as just the Son of God. He had, you know, this. He was the Son of God, so he was this supreme being that didn't feel anything that we feel as humans. But this shows that Jesus was feeling sorrowful and heavy at what he was about to go through.
Yes, sir.
So feeling sorrowful or heavy ain't a problem, but it's how you deal with that sorrow and that heaviness that matters most.
Come on.
Then saith he unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, My soul, my mind, my memories, my intellect, my imagination is exceeding sorrowful.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And so, because when stuff happens, nobody is exempt from going through what happens. And so when this happened, I remember Apostle, you know, his soul was troubled. Like we look at John 12, his soul was troubled. So he asked God, you got to tell me, you know, what's going on here. And so what God told him was, you know, don't let it be a soul issue. Because a lot of times when things happen, we only look at it in the ramifications of our soul. And we keep it locked up there and we try to handle it from that position. But your soul ain't strong enough to handle it if you don't let your spirit influence your soul.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And so now, because what we got to understand, too, is don't nobody in this room know what happened. Because wasn't nobody in the room when it happened. And so now we can't go to assuming and speculating and creating false narratives about what happened and trying to figure it out in our mind what happened when we don't know.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So if I don't know, I cannot allow my soul to stay troubled by what I don't know. So what I do know is who God is. What I do know is who Jesus is. And what I do know is who the Holy Spirit is. And so during that time, he said, don't let it be a soul issue. And so, you know, when things happen, you immediately start running through your mind. You start running through, you know, what is this? Could it be there? Could it be there? And so don't let it be that issue. Because now if you keep it there, you go stay there.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
If you keep it in your soul, you're going to stay in that position for as long as you let it stay there. But I have to allow the Spirit to come in. I have to allow the Spirit to handle what I don't know.
Right.
Yes, sir. Because in life, there's a lot of stuff that we don't know. So that's why I say take no thought for tomorrow, because we don't know what tomorrow is.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But now if I'm steady, constantly thinking about tomorrow, next week, that's why people be stressed out. Because they keep thinking about stuff that they don't know. The only thing that you can prepare for or prepare is yourself. You could plan out tomorrow as most eloquently as you can. You could have every hour mapped out. But that don't mean that tomorrow gonna be the way that you mapped it out. And so now if something changes, oh snap, now my whole day going to shot? Or now I'm in the pits because I can't stand what's going on? Or do I prepare myself and so no matter what comes, I'm able to stand in the midst of that thing?
Yes, sir.
So that don't matter what happens in life, I'm able to stand because I am in a position to where I'm in rest.
Right, 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 right.
So that's why when we go to Matthew 11 and 28, that's why Jesus said, come to me. And so that's something that I had to do. I had to go to him because ain't nobody else had the answers. Nobody else had the answers.
Yes, sir.
There's some deep burning questions in my soul, but nobody else know those answers.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And so that's why, thank you, Holy Spirit, the room is so important because when you go in that room, you dump everything that you got in that room. You dump everything that you don't know in that room.
Yes, sir.
Because when I don't know, I got to give it to him. And so now he could infuse himself where I don't know. And so there's a void sometimes about what we don't know. We keep it there. I don't know. I'm confused. I'm questioning what's going on. And so now the more we have that brood and we don't invite him in, he can't. And so now any place that there's hurt is a place for him to be able to heal.
Come on.
Any place. So that's any place. You're hurting your childhood. It's not for you to ignore. A lot of times we try to ignore stuff and make it and act like it don't exist. And so this isn't a message of ignoring. This is a message of freedom. This is a message of being productive and giving God everything that's on the inside of you. Because ignoring, you know, because we could be ignoring, we could be in denial. Denial is not a good place to be. The only place that I could be is acknowledging what's going on, acknowledging what I don't know. God, I don't know what the hell is going on here.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Because my plans wasn't this.
That's right.
my plans was different from this. And so now, how do I stand in the midst of what's going on? That's why I have to trust in the sovereignty of God. I have to trust that he's all sovereign, that his will reigns supreme. No matter if I don't understand it, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. Acknowledge him in all, not just some or the ones that you want to, but all of them. And he will direct your paths. But I have to be able to give it to him. And so I have to be able to let him in where I'm hurting. I can't, I could box everybody else out. I could put walls up for everybody else, but I can't put walls up for him. I gotta let him in where I'm hurting at so he can touch that thing. And so come on, let's go back to Matthew 26 real quick. Jesus here, right? My soul is exceeding sorrowful. Things in my marriage not going the way that I think they ought to. My soul is exceeding sorrowful. My kids seem like they can't get right. They just don't want to go the way that I've trained them to go. My situation, my career, my life, I seem like I can't stand on 2 feet long enough. Seems like as soon as I stand up, I get knocked right back down. My soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. What's the rest of the verse say? Tarry ye here. Watch with me. Because watch with me means pray with me. Because there, and that's why everything always lines up, no matter if we understand what it means or not. Because, you know, I didn't know, you know, what the widow had to do with me. I didn't know why that story meant so much to me, or why it impressed on my heart for so long. Like, why is it with me this long? Because today, God wanted me to be able to show you how to shut that door. To be able to shut the door to your soul to where you can go in and have peace and freedom. My soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Because Jesus got to do something that don't seemingly, you know, ain't going to be too good. Ain't going to feel too good. Amen. Don't nobody just want to, you know, even though we know and we thank him for what he knew he had to do and still doing it, don't mean that he wanted to. Just because stuff going on in your life don't mean that you want to deal with it. Don't mean that you understand it. Don't mean that you like it. But how do you go from that moment? Tarry ye here and watch with me. And he went a little further and fell on his face. Lord Jesus, you have to have a falling on your face moment. I don't care how strong you think you are. I don't care what experiences in life you've gone through that you think have built you for this. There's only one thing that builds you to be able to handle all things. And he fell on his face and prayed, saying, "Oh, my Father, if it be possible, let what I'm going through not have to happen." Even, because in my hurt, I was trying to bargain with God. Just like Jesus, I was trying to bargain with him. I was saying, "Lord, you know, let this not be so. No, let me take his place. Let me go instead of him." No, that's what I real life prayed. That's what I real life prayed. Come on, you another. Yeah, because my love for him is so strong that I believe in who God created him to be so much that I want him to be able to keep going.
Yes, sir.
So now, I want you to look at Jesus, because now, here it is. And so now God had to ask me, who do you love more? Do you love him more or do you love me more? And that's a question everybody has to deal with.
Yes, sir.
Because our lives can't be a figment of our imagination, or it can't be this fairy dust of Christianity. It got to be real.
Yes, sir.
It's cool to come in here and lift our hands and praise God, see him get the word. But once we walk out of that door, we got to be able to live.
Yeah. Come on.
And not just in the form of Christ, but that real Christ.
Yes, sir.
That real unity with the Father.
Yes, sir.
Not just, thank God, Holy Spirit, yeah, cool all that. But then, because we cannot let practicality take the place of spirituality.
Yes, sir.
Because in this day and age, we try to be so practical with things to where we're trying to do this thing, that thing, this step, that step, to where we don't allow the Spirit to be able to lead us. That's why people that go to church, what's the note? What's the steps? I want to know, no, but how do I do this? Give me 1, 2, 3. Give me A, B, C. We want a formula or a prescription for something. But everything ain't gonna be the same. So that's why through anything that I go through, I have to be able to go to him. Because in going to him, he gonna give me a different prescription. It's gonna be different from the last one. And so he asked me, who do you love more? Do you love him more or do you love me more? Because if I'm so hurt by that transition, by him going to be with the Father, then do I really believe in what Jesus did? So what I'm going through, do I believe that this is greater than Jesus? Whatever your situation in life is, do I believe that this is stronger than Jesus? Because it said that he rose up with all power in his hands. And so now, if he rose up with all power, then when I stand up, in that same power. But I cannot allow it to remain a soul issue. I can't let it be something that I try to deal with in my soul. Because Jesus knew that his soul, like, just think about it. If, you know, you was here and you was doing a bunch of stuff and then God say, you know, now it's time to actually do the finished work of what you came to do. Yeah, you've been healing the people. You've been delivering them with demons. You've been feeding them. You've been doing good works. You've been healing the blind. You've been making the lame walk. Cool. Now it's time to die. Wait a minute, God. What you mean?
Hallelujah.
Like, I know who I am. I know who you are, but we got a good thing going. We got a real good thing going, God. Like, let's keep this ball rolling. Like, we can go into all the world and preach the gospel. Because you say the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. So now I can go into all the world. But now my soul's sorrowful because it's time for me to deal with a real life situation. Something that's going to take from me.
Yes.
But I can't look at it as taking from me. I got to look at it as gaining.
Yes. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That's why he say, you know, you can gain the whole world and lose your soul. So don't try to save your life. Because if you're trying to save it, you're going to lose it.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I believe that if Jesus would have tried to save his life,
yes,
man, it would have been sad to see somebody actually kill Jesus. Because they didn't kill him. He said, I give my life. You can't take my life. I give it. But now in not following tonight, that's why he said, come on, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Let this pain pass from me. Let this sorrow pass from me. Let this uncertainty about life pass from me. Because I didn't know what life was about to be like. I've only been so accustomed to life one way. Only one way. I don't know life no other way but that way. And so now when that way changes, I have to make sure that I stay in the way.
Yes, sir.
So now I'm like, God, I'm uncertain. I don't know what's going on. Because you got to understand, that's why in life, we have to be prepared for every moment. And we have to let our expectations be from him. Because when our expectations are self-built, then we can be disappointed when those expectations don't reach the fulfillment of what we expected. Just look at your life. That's why some people say you don't have no expectations, but I don't believe you should have no expectations. I think your expectations ought to be from him. That's what the scripture says. Let your expectations be from God. Don't build your own expectations. Let him give you his expectations. Because in his expectations, he go fulfill his expectations. And so when we do that, so now I'm like, come on, like, I don't know what's about to happen in life. You know, I'm not ready for this, God. In my mind, I believe that I had like a good 25 more years before I had to step into this place.
Come on.
Further down the line. Yes, sir. And so now it's not about my plan. It's about his plan. So in my hurt, I can't allow this to be more than Jesus. I cannot allow this to be more than what he paid for. Because now if I believe in who he is and what he did, then I believe that Dr. Phil is somewhere far better than down here. So do I miss him? Heavens, yes. But the best way to, let's keep reading. On my fault, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt.
Yes.
And he cometh to his disciples and finding them asleep and said unto Peter, what could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray. Because when you pray like me, you're able to see like me. That's why it says Jesus was able to see the joy that was set before him. That's why he was able to endure the cross. He wasn't looking at what was around him or what he was on, but he was looking at every single person in this room. He was looking at everything that was set ahead of him by him doing what he had to do. And so now when you watch and pray, you get to see beyond your situation. But when you're in your situation and you're looking at it from your soul perspective, it looked like hell on earth. It looked like a place that you don't want to be. But now I can't allow my life to be lived that way. Because now if I live that way, I'm going to be depressed. I'm going to be hurting myself. I'm going to be hurting other people. Like, and so it's going to be a cycle. And so now the word says that the only thing that benefits the word or that shows the word is the fruit of the word. The only thing that shows the life of Christ is the fruit of his life. So, you know, I was battling in my soul because, you know, I was going about doing my father's business. But I was, you know, saying, you know, because, you know, other people, you know, they was crying and, you know, they were doing all this. I was like, you know, maybe, you know, I should be, you know, doing this a little bit more. Is something wrong that I'm not doing this? Or, you know, like, is something wrong that I'm not crying or, you know, I'm not, you know, lamenting. I'm not, you know, just kind of, you know, falling out and just kind of, you know, extremely hurtful. Like, something wrong with me. Because society says that when something like this happens or something drastic or traumatic in your life happens, if you look at it as a trauma, you're supposed to respond a certain way. So you're supposed to be grieving. You're supposed to be going through, you know, a certain period of this, a certain period of that. Because, like I said, like, I could have went after that time and I could have went on a world tour. Not a preaching world tour, but I could have been on a prodigal son world tour. I could have been going around doing, you know, a bunch of riotous living. I could have been going from here to there, from her to her, all over the place. From city to city, from woman to woman, from bottle to bottle, and nobody would have blinked the eye at it. Everybody was like, oh, I understand what he's going through. You know, they got to be something, you know, strong and tormenting. So, you know, just let him, he going to be all right. Let him be. And I could have lived my life and I could have been destructed and nobody else would have cared. All the people that, talking about, let him live or he going to be all right. Or the same people that's crying, talking about, you know, I wish Dr. Phil was still here. Just ain't the same. You know, I wish I could talk to him again. Talk to him again for what? You didn't listen the last three times you talked to her. You think the fourth one gonna be the one? Like, what you think? You think the fourth one gonna be the one? And so that's why it cannot be a soul issue. Because I remember the message before he transitioned, the Sunday before, he taught a scripture. He says, and I wish I could quote it right, but it says, how you be much more in my absence. Like, how are you going to be when I'm not here? That's why, you know, you can't let it be a soul or earthly thing. Like, contrary to what you want to believe, I just believe that it was a spiritual thing. Whether your mind could go there or not, I don't care. But I just don't think God talks aimlessly. I just don't think things happen by happenstance. I think it's all a part of God's plan. And so, because now what, and that's why we have to get back to a place in Christ to where the actual foundation that he laid, we build on that foundation. And so in church, we got a lot of other buildings and a lot of other statues and a lot of other monuments that's not built on that foundation. That's why Apostle Paul had to go back and start correcting, because y'all ain't doing this right. So that's why church has been so long a corrective sphere, because we're always trying to correct wrong behavior, because we're not standing on the right foundation. And so now the thing that matters in our life is that we express the life of Christ. And so I could have been crying. I could have been. What good would I have been if every time I got up here, I was crying and weeping? You wouldn't have been no good. You wouldn't have been no good. If she wouldn't have been here 2 weeks later, you wouldn't have been no good. If she had missed a year of church, you wouldn't have been no good. Half of y'all wouldn't even be sitting here right now. That's why, because we got to look at the life of Jesus. That's why, because when all of this happened, I began to see Jesus more clear than I ever saw him before in my life. And I actually took on the persona of Jesus. Because how he handles things, that's the blueprint for my life. And so I can't take a world's way, I can't adopt that way of living life and thinking how I should act or respond or live. I got to take on his way. Otherwise, I got to be honest about what I believe. And so either I believe who he is or I don't. And so now in the midst of that, I had to take a step back and I had to allow God to strengthen me. And so now let's turn to Matthew chapter 6. Because the thing that Jesus wanted most, and that's why he made disciples, that's why he told them to follow me, because when I leave off the scene, I need y'all to walk like me. I need y'all to live like me. I need y'all to be me on earth. I need you to be me in earth and be me on earth. So that's why you saw some of those, that's why Apostle Paul corrected some of them, because they had started teaching something other than him. They had started going back to the law and had left grace.
Yes, sir.
Not just what he did, but who he is.
Yes, sir. Come on. Yes, sir.
You know, Peter started going back to his traditions and stuff. Like, Peter, what is you doing?
Right.
And so that's why Jesus, he wasn't so focused, like he was building them around him, but he knew that there would be people later on down the line who would be able to see him for who he truly is.
That's it.
So that's why he said the joy that was set before him. And so now, it don't matter who around me, I know that there's people that I'm doing this for ahead of me. But the people who are around me, they are the ones who are supposed to be carrying me out. And so people were supposed to be carrying Jesus out. What good would it have done the disciples who were apostles to be crying and to be hurting and to be depressed because Jesus was no longer with them? What church would they have established? And so now the life of Jesus is null and void. Now he got to come back. I got to have another virgin birth to try to do it again. Because you're supposed to be able to carry out what I've lived before you. My life wasn't a show, but it was to show you how to live. And so I can't, like, all right. Right now, right? Dr. Phil isn't present on this earth, right? So what good does it for him not to be present here and for you not to be present here? What good does it do him not to be present here and for you to be weak? What good does it do for him not to be here and for you to be a loser? Because he was building winners. So now, if I'm in a position to where I felt like I've lost something, then that might mean that you never had it. And so now we got to look at the life of Jesus. The same way Jesus lived here, we are to carry out his life. And so what good would it do us to be in here teaching about a philosopher or somebody? Or to be teaching, you know, the gospel of Kobe Bryant? Kobe ain't did nothing for me. Thank you. Kobe ain't did nothing for me. Jesus did it for me. And so now I have to walk after Jesus. So how was Jesus walking? He was led by the Spirit. So turn with me to Mark chapter 1 real quick. Because God told me to tell you that you're focusing too much on what happened and what you're going through. He say, you looking at the story instead of my glory.
Right.
And so, you know, growing up, a story wasn't nothing but another word for a lie. And so what you're going through, you cannot look at it as the truth for your life. You have to be able to see the deception in it by not looking at it, but looking at him. That's why I say looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Don't be looking at everything else going on in life. Keep your eyes stayed on Jesus. Mark 1, let's go to verse 35. And in the morning, rising up a great while before day, he went out and departed into a solitary place, and there prayed him. And Simon and they that were with him followed after him, and when they had found him, they said unto him, all men seek for thee. And he said unto them, let us go into the next towns, that I may preach there also, for therefore came I forth. And so now we see a glimpse of what Jesus did here. In his life, in his ministry, he went up and he prayed. He communed with the Father. Because now when I go and I commune with the Father, when I go to that solitary place, then I can be strengthened.
That's right.
And so that's why, help me, Holy Ghost. The solitary place and the secret place are the same place. We have to be more in love with the secret place than the public space. We got to be more in love. We're not trying to show things to people and be in the public eye of people and be so in love with spending time in that secret place.
Yes, sir.
Turn me to John. Turn me to John. Turn me to John. Lord Jesus, help me. Thank you, Jesus. Turn me to Luke 4. Luke 4. Are you being helped this morning? Because I'm not here bragging on me, but I'm bragging on him.
Yeah.
Because in life, there ain't no way for you to be able to go through whatever you go through on your own. I don't care how strong you think you is, how tough you think you is. You can't go through it on your own. It'll crush you.
Yes, sir.
But now with him, you can put me up against anything. Because what I've gone through is, in my mind, the biggest mountain I can ever face. It's the biggest battle I can ever face in my life. And so now that didn't take me out. Shit, you better believe like it's only popping. You better believe it's only popping. Hey, like, I'm still able to stand strong. Like the thing I thought was gonna be the most detrimental, the most tragic thing, I thought it was gonna be the end for me. You mean to tell me that I'm still standing and I'm strong? So that's why it doesn't matter what comes up in life, I receive the seed. Because if I've already understood and got the revelation of who God is and who Jesus is, and that revelation has developed me and built me up to the point to where I was able to stand and that thing didn't defeat me.
Yeah.
The thing that I thought was gonna be the most, like, you actually, you know, transitioning and not being on this earth might be the most devastating thing that you think that, like, I don't know what your thing is, but for me, that was the thing for me. Because, because the thing that I did is that whenever I had a question, I went to him.
All right.
About anything, whenever I thought or saw I had a question, I went to him. He was my go-to for any question that I ever had. About my spirituality, about my, anything. I went to him. And so what I had to come to grips with is that I put a whole lot more stock or trust in him and not the one who sent him. Because yes, he is my man of God. He's putting my life for me to be able to go to, but not for me to go to for everything. Because I cannot let him take the place of my Father in heaven. Because if I put him on that pedestal, I put him in a place to where he's my God and God's not my God. And so things, it's real easy in life for us to put things ahead of him. Even if we don't readily or consciously identify them as we esteeming them ahead of him, it's very easy for us to do those things. All we have to do is trace our actions and what we're doing. But it's very easy for us to do those things. But now we have to come to grips with, we have to allow God to be who he is in our life. Be seated. Luke 4, chapter 4, verse 14. And Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit into Galilee, and there went out a fame of him through all the region round about. And so Jesus returned in power. Where was he at? What did he return from? Jesus had just been in the wilderness. He had just been in a place where it was time for him to be taught and for him to pass the test of his teaching. So now let's go back to verse 13. And when the devil had ended all the temptation, he departed from him for a season. And so what this shows us is that, like I said, the wilderness is going to always come in our lives. There's always going to be situations teaching us and helping us express or uncover or unfold or present or reveal who we truly are. That's why it's not who you are when everything's going good. It's who you are during those tough times, during those hardships. That's when we see the man of man or the man of woman that you really are. Not when everything all hunky-dory. Not when, you know, all the lights and, you know, all the sparkly dust and the glitter and everything everywhere. Not when all the balloons flying. And not when that time. It's times when you're going through something.
Yes, right.
When the things of this world tries to put you in a position to where you don't recognize who you are.
Yes, sir.
But in those times, just like Jesus, I have to be able to know who I am.
Yes, sir.
And so I love it. In the first part of that wilderness, that temptation, it was him eating.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Then he tried to teach him something, eating. But not that's Jesus or not. We have to look at Jesus as who we are.
Yes.
Jesus was showing us that you can deny the thing that Adam couldn't. The thing that somebody else couldn't withstand, you can. The thing that somebody else failed to succeed at, you can. The thing that somebody else allowed society and culture to tell them and teach them how to act, you can do the exact opposite. But that's what Jesus was showing us the whole time. It don't matter who came before you, who else is beside you, who else is doing what. You can. And so now, between verse 13, and when the devil had ended all the temptation, he departed from him for a season, and verse 14, and Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit into Galilee, and there went out a fame of him through all the region around about. There was something that happened between verse 13 and verse 14.
Yes.
Turn with me to Matthew 6. Matthew 6, verse 6. But thou, when thou prayest, when you hurting the most, when you the most uncertain, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut thy door, 'cause you are not even in your closet until you shut the door. You are not in a place to where I can minister to you until you shut that door. Because we see in another description of that temptation in the wilderness, it says that Jesus was ministered to by the angels. And so what happens is, it comes a time that before I can return in power, I gotta go somewhere first. Because doing those things in the wilderness, I'm positive that Jesus was deplenished.
Yeah.
He was hurting. He was tired. He just, you know, he was like, man, you know, I didn't have to go through all this. But during that time, it's time for me to go inside.
Yes.
And so now, you know, like this room, this is only a symbol for you.
Yes.
Like, you know, your closet, you know, it can be a physical place. But it got to be this physical place more than any other physical place. No matter if, because now if you're in a situation, if you got this certain place that you got to go to, then you ain't going to be able to go there if you're not there. But I can always go on the inside. No matter where I'm at, I can go in. But then when I go in, I got to shut the door. And so anything that's keeping me from completely locking. So now if my soul is troubled, that's why I got to go in and I got to dip and dump, because I got to dump everything that's in my soul that's not like him.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I got to be able to dump all of that stuff out, because that's the only way, because Jesus, thank you, Holy Spirit. Turn me to John 2. So I remember that widow, right? You remember she poured out, right?
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Spirit.
Yes, sir.
Because now, hey, Because, you know, she took into that room a bunch of vessels with her. But when you go in that room, you're only taking one vessel with you. And so anytime, and so we're going to look at this instance, right? Thank you, Holy Spirit. We look at Jesus. And so because with Jesus, you got to be able to connect the dots. You got to be able to see he's always teaching you something. So now you can't take this lesson and separate it from this lesson. They got something in this lesson that completes this lesson. Because Jesus said, I didn't come to do away with the law, but I came to fulfill it. And so even though you know this thing, there's something else that needs to be added to it. And so now, when you go in that closet, you're not going in that closet by yourself. And so, I love it so much. Because when you go in there, let's turn to Hebrews real quick. Hebrews. Sheesh. See you, Trail. Hebrews chapter 7. Verse 25. Wherefore he is able to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him. So who is we talking about? Jesus. Talk about Jesus, right? Seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. So that means when you're going in that room, Jesus making intercession for you. So like I was expecting Pastor Jay to break down. You know why I ain't broke down and why I can't break down? Because I'm constantly being built up. Because I was able to see, and you know, I immediately do it because whenever Dr. Phil needed to get away, he would go to the back, to the lake house. And so where did I spend majority of last year? In the lake house. No, I want to be real with you. I spent, and not only just spent time, but I spent all my time. Like I spent the night. Nights. There was months upon months where that's where I slept at. There was months where I slept in a recliner in the lake house. Because the example that was set before me and the example that was set before him is that anytime you need to be productive in life, you need to go somewhere. You need to shut the door. On whatever's going on, you need to spend time with the Father. We can go to a lot of other people, and a lot of people can give us a lot of advice, and they can give us more than advice. They give us opinions of what they think. But what you think don't matter if it ain't the truth. So there's only one way for me to get to the truth, and that's for me to go to the Father. And so I spent time just staying in the lake house, and she was like, I want you ready for you to come in the house. And I was like, I'm coming, but you know, there's something I gotta just do right now. There's a wilderness that I gotta be in right now where I stay locked in the lake house. Let me see. It's only been maybe about what, 2 months maybe since I've been back in the house? About a month then? About a month then. No, it was around Christmas or something, wasn't it? It was around Christmas. I think it was around Christmas. But I just got back in the house. But I've been in a lake house because in my mind, I had to put myself in his shoes. And so I had to put myself in his shoes a whole lot more than what I saw him in them in. And so I can't just take the time that he spent in there and think, you know, I can spend that same amount of time and, you know, I'm going to be all right. No. Hey, he got a lot more years that he spent time like that. And so now I can't try to match time for time, but I have to match energy for energy. I have to match connection for connection. Like, there's one thing that he was connected to more than anything, and he still is even more today than he was back then, is that the Father, that's why I love Jesus. Jesus say, I and the Father, John 10:30, I and the Father are one. Yes. And so what reinforces that knowledge or that revelation is me going into that secret place. And so now, John 2. Holy Spirit, thank you, yeah. Holy Spirit gave me this one, yeah. I can't drop what the Holy Spirit didn't gave me, you know, I gotta make sure he didn't gave me all of it, but he just gave me this on the spot, so I gotta give you this. And so now when you go, Matthew 6, too, when you go in that closet, right? Jesus make intercession for you, and so, this is what Jesus says when you go in that closet. Because it don't matter. You can go in that closet empty. You can go in that closet on a half a tank, on a quarter of a tank, on, you know, 20 miles till empty. You know, someone will be driving, you know, how many miles I got? I can make it. But in life, it ain't that same way. You cannot go by the mileage gauge to see how far you can go in life. Because you might get caught in some traffic and you might not be able to make it to the filling station. So in life, no matter if I'm in traffic or not, I got to be able to go in. And so now, once I go in, I shut the door. And now you hear Jesus saying, verse 7, fill the water pots with water. And they filled them up to the brim. You hear Jesus making intercession for you to the Father, saying, fill them up. No matter whether they came in here empty or what, they maybe it was just one area they needed fulfilling in. Fill them up. Because now, hold on. Thank you, Holy Spirit. What woman at the well at? John 3? No, John 4. John 4. Hey, and so now we got this woman at the well, right? Let me skim and so let me go down. Thank you, Holy Spirit. All right. Verse 6. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being weary with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. And so we go on. Four disciples were going away unto the city to buy meat. Then said the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. And so Jesus, that's why I love Jesus, because Jesus was dealing with racism. Like, I don't care who say I ain't supposed to be talking to you. I don't care what color he is. Don't none of that matter, because the Father don't see color. The Father only see oneness. Come on, help me, Holy Ghost. Where we at? Jesus said unto her, if thou knowest the gift of God and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. The woman said unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Because, you know, when you go to the well to get water, you got to have something to put the water in. And so, so we go to John 2. Verse 7, Jesus said unto them, fill the water pots with water. So this is not too long after he say, fill the water pots with water, right? Thank you, Holy Ghost. Jesus answered saying to her, whosoever drinketh this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. The woman said unto him, sir, give me this water that I thirst not. Give me this water. Neither come hither to draw. Jesus said to her, go, call thy husband and come hither. The woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said unto her, thou hast well said, I have no husband, for thou hast had five husbands. And so Jesus isn't in the spirit of condemnation, but he is in the spirit of prophecy and conviction. Because now, in order for you to be whole, you have to understand that you empty some places. Because I can't fill the places that you cover up. The places that you try to hide, I can't fill those places up. You got to be transparent, and you got to be able to admit where you got holes at. Because a lot of people try to use that and say, like, see, Jesus was he wasn't judging her, but he was letting her know that I see you. Because he was showing the Father, God saying, I see you. Like, I know where you're hurting at, but you got to be able to admit where that hurt at, and you got to be able to get that hurt to me. Because I can't heal what you don't give me. If you don't get that hurt to me, if you try to handle that hurt on your own, in your soul, in your humanism, you're going to stay hurt. But only when you're able to give it to me can I heal you. This is good to me. I don't know if it's good to nobody else. This is good to me. But thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou now hast is not thy husband, and that says thou truly. The woman said unto him, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. you think so? You think so? Because, you know, people might have known about the other five, but ain't nobody know about the one she was with right now. But Jesus. Our fathers worship in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus said unto her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh. Keep going. When ye shall neither in this mountain nor ye yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. So you don't know what you're worshiping, but we do know what we're worshiping. And so I'm trying to show you what we're worshiping. But that's why he said, come unto me and I'll give you rest. Come unto me and I'll show you how to be one with the Father. But the hour cometh and now is when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. The woman said unto him, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he is come, he will tell us all things. Jesus said unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. So what I'm telling you is the things that's going to come. And so now I desire to give you water that you'll never thirst again. And so out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. So I know they got a Messiah coming into Christ, and he go tell, yeah, that's me. So that's why we need not go to anybody but him. He knows. And so, and upon this came his disciples and marveled. They always marveling that he talked with the woman. Yet no man said, ain't nobody say, what seekest thou or why talkest thou with her? Because they knew when to and not to test Jesus. The woman then left. This is it right here. The woman then left her water pot and went her way into the city and said to the men, come see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? And so that's it right there in verse 28. The woman then left her water pot. And so in John 2, verse 7, Jesus said unto them, fill the water pots with water. And they filled them to the brim. And so she came to the well to get water with her water pot. But then she left without her water pot. Jesus told them to fill the water pots to the brim. He said to her, I'll give you water that you never thirst again. She came to the well with a water pot. but she left from the well as a water pot. Because you have to know that that room is you. And so now when you go into that room, just like in verse 7, Jesus interceding for you saying, fill him up. Fill her up. Fill him up, God. Fill him up to the brim, till he overflow. Fill her up till she overflow. Fill her up till she can't take no more. But it's not for you to go in. With something. And so now, it's cool if you do go in with something. You can go in with something. But once you shut that door, you're coming back out without it. But I have to know that it's for me to go into that room. Yes, sir. And so, just like in Mark 1, 35, that solitary place, and so you know I cannot teach a message like this without going to a passage like this. Yes, sir. That solitary place is the same as that secret place. And so now I gotta go to Psalms 91. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Because now, when you stay in the secret place, you stay under the shadow of the Almighty. So there's protection, there's provisions, there's prevailing. That's when you go to pray. That's when you go for your peace. You go there to the secret place to receive all of that in your water pot. So you need peace? Go in a secret place. You need provisions? Go in a secret place. You need protection? Go in a secret place. You need to prevail in life? Go in the secret place. The secret place is the most precious place that there is in life. So that's why we can't be so excited about the public space. Let's go back to Matthew 6. I'm coming back. I'm gonna read the rest of that 91 Psalm. You know that's his favorite Psalm now. So you know I can't preach this and not read that. Teachings I receive a seed. Say teachings on prayer. Come on, I'm gonna use that to hold my place. And verse 5. And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites. Because the secret place is more important to the public space.
Yes, sir. All right. All right. Yes, sir.
Because in the secret, that's why in Jude 20 it says, building up myself in my most holy faith. Praying in the Holy Ghost. That's why when I go in there, I could say some things in English, but I need to be praying much more in the Holy Ghost than I'm praying in English. Because when I pray in the Holy Ghost, I'm praying the mind of the Spirit. And so now, in praying the mind of the Spirit, I get the mind of God. And so, thank you, Holy Spirit. And so now, when you pray in the Spirit, you actually prophesying. And it's much more powerful than a prophecy that you could speak on your own, because it's the Holy Spirit speaking it for you. And so now, if he knows things to come, if he knows all things, and now if I allow him to pray through me, then he's praying those all things, those things to come right now. And so even though right now I might have went in with a lot of hell around me, when he prays for me, when he intercedes for me, I come back out. I didn't prophesy while I was in. And so now when I come out, I see things differently because I've been built up. And so I can't break down when I'm being built up. You've been breaking down, you need to start building up. Because when you built up, you cannot break down when you built up.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Things may come, things may hit you, things may rock, but you can't get broken down. Yeah, I'm gonna finish this. Come on. So when I pray, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues. They love praying up in church. They love praying on Facebook and on Instagram. Go ahead, send me your prayer request so I can pray for you. They love that. They love saying, "Oh, they spiritual. They, you know, they love that." But don't pray like them. Amen. And so, ain't nothing wrong with doing that, but that cannot be the only place where you're praying. Like, the public space has to be fueled by the secret place. Because you can meet your friend or something, you can pray for them out in public, but that gotta come from you spending time in your secret place.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That's why, because I don't want nobody praying for me that ain't spend no time in the secret place. You ain't spend no time praying nowhere else other than right here? You can keep that prayer. I can pray a whole lot better for myself. That's why you got to be careful, though, you know, who you let pray for you, who you let lay hands on you.
Yes, sir.
Everybody, you know, everybody able, but everybody shouldn't be able to. But you can't be letting everybody just pray for you. Let me pray for you. Nah, I'm straight. They won't touch you, lay their hands on you. You want to pray for me? Cool. Do it on your own time. You ain't got to put your hands on me. Because now you transferring something. I don't want you to be putting nothing on me. So I gotta be more in tune to that secret place. Because they go, verse 5, in the synagogues, and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But you, when you pray, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut the door, pray to thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. And so that's why so many times, and I shift gears a little bit here, people, they get in a place of stagnation, or they get in a place of trying to make things happen on their own because they haven't spent enough time in a secret place. Because we know there's a scripture that says your gift to make room for you, but that gift is a secret gift. It cannot make no room if you don't develop it in a secret. You can't develop a gift, and all we got to develop it in a secret. Let me just go to a practical application of this in my life. When I came home from school and, you know, I started volunteering in the ministry, I didn't work here, I didn't get paid, I volunteered. I gave free time. I wanted to work in the media department. And so one thing that I did, I wanted to learn, because I had learned how to do graphics the wrong way. I did it in a video editing program. And that's just not how you do it. But I was just trying to do what I saw somebody else do, and I was trying to do it the best way I knew how. But once I learned that Photoshop was the way, I was staying up until 5 and 6 o'clock in the morning working on Photoshop.
Yeah. Come on, sir.
Trying to learn, watching tutorials, working on stuff, trying to get better at it.
Yes.
Because it's in the secret that those gifts are developed.
Yes.
Even if God has given, because in our family, we have a very artistic and creative background. Like, there's a lot of artists in our family. There's a lot of people who got different, we got photography, we got drugs. Because I remember, I told y'all before, Dr. Phil used to have this contest at Martin Luther King Junior Christian Academy where we had to draw a portrait of Martin Luther King for Martin Luther King Day, and I used to win every year, but he used to draw it for me. Every year they'd be like, "Man, you keep getting better and better." I say, "Yeah, I am, ain't I?" But he's a drunk with me every year, so we've had that. We have that in our genes. And I got cousins, you know, they very gifted at a lot of my uncle. We got so many giftings in art. Leanne, like, we got so many giftings in art in our family. And but just having that gift isn't enough. That gift has to be cultivated. That gift has to be mastered. And so now let's go to the master. You know, we don't see Jesus for 18 years, right? Jesus was in a secret place for 18 years, being hidden, developing, cultivating, mastering the gift that he is. Because at 12, that gift wasn't ready. He was ready to function in it, but the gift wasn't ready to function in him. Because I can't just throw you out there and hope that, you know, you survive. Because a father ain't going to do that. A father's going to protect. A mother's going to protect. That's why Mary say, come on back here with your mom and your daddy. And then for 18 years, we don't hear nothing else about Jesus. Because during that time, I'm mastering something. That's why they say he was a master builder. Because in carpentry, he was mastering that skill. And in mastering that skill, he was mastering his skill. He was mastering his gift. But now, so now, once it gets time for your gift to be put on the grand stage, it's going to come after you being able to master that thing.
Right.
Don't try to go out there before it's ahead of time.
That's right.
Because you're going to get destroyed. Like I say, every one of us got a message. But you cannot try to preach your message before you have allowed the Holy Spirit to minister and get you all the way in a position to where you have your gift, to where can't nobody detest or accuse you of anything. Couldn't nobody find that in Jesus, because I've been on the backside of the mountain. I've been in my father's wood shop. I've been learning how to build these tables. And so now, learning from Joseph, he was learning from Joseph and learning from God at the same time. That's why we can't throw away the life of Joseph. Because it was very vital to the life of Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Because we talk about Mary.
Yeah.
And we talk about Jesus.
Right.
A lot of times we leave out Joseph. But Joseph had to be a man to be able to understand the role that God had him in the life of Jesus. That's why when they was killing the baby, Joseph said, we got to get out of here because I got to protect this seed.
Right.
And so now that same thing happened through our life. And so now, earthly father, what is it that you find interest in? What is it that you called to do? I'm called to do that same thing. Talking about Jesus. Joseph, what are you called to do? You called to be a carpenter? You called to be a builder? I'm called to be that same thing. And so now he takes the gift of learning how to build tables and chairs and houses or whatever, and then he learns how to build people. But my gift has to be cultivated. Otherwise, there's no room for it. And so at the baptism, right? How could God say, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased? When Jesus hadn't done nothing for 18 years. But just because you ain't seen him do nothing don't mean he wasn't doing nothing. The Father was pleased with his secret time. The time that he had spent in the secret place. The place out of the sight of everybody else when it's just me and him. So now I know that I can put you out and you can go into all the world preaching me and delivering me to people because you spent time with me.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So that's why Jesus could make the statement, I and my Father are one, because for 18 to 30 years, that's all I've been doing. I've been in secret. So now you marveling at what I'm doing right here in year one. That ain't because of right now. That's because of the 30 years before now. But it takes time in that secret place. Come on, turn back to John 14. No, Luke 4. So I want to give you this. Because it has to be something that takes place. I don't want to just be going in a room, I want something to happen to me in the room. So now we didn't been in the room, right?
Yes, sir.
Luke 4:14. We didn't been in the room, right?
Yes,
And so now, after leaving the room, and Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit into Galilee. So now, when you return, you don't return as you anymore, but you return in the Spirit. So whatever you were facing, you don't come back facing it as the same person. You come up built up as a better version of yourself. And so the way to get the best version of yourself is to keep on getting to the better versions of yourself. And so now I got to keep going. So let's keep reading. Yeah. And he taught in their synagogues and being glorified of all, and he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as his custom was, he sent into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. And there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found a place where it was written. So he went searching for this place, right? That don't mean he just any old scripture. No, he went and found a specific scripture. And so now the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Let's go back to verse 14. He returned in the power of the Spirit. So when you, even though you might go into that secret place hurting or wounded, when you come back, you return in the power of the Spirit. And so not only do you return in the power of the Spirit, but that's why I love Jesus, because he shows us that when you return that power, there's another level that you got to go in. And so now I go into that room in faith. But when I come out of that room, I come out of that room anointed. The problem that the issue that most people have is that they try to handle situations that are meant for them, but they don't handle them in the anointing. Because there's an anointing for that situation, but you got to be anointed for it. And so now you can't think. And so now the Spirit is in you. But now when you go in that room, not only does the Spirit grow up in you, but then there's a Spirit that becomes upon you. So many people try to handle situations from just not even the spirit that's in them, but just the soul that's in them. But now I got to understand that certain situations are for me to deliver God to that situation. And so now I got to be anointed for that situation. Because that situation in your life for a reason. Like you're not just dealing with that for no reason. Like God didn't put that up for no reason. Like it's not there. Oh, man, how this happen? No, it's there for a reason. Yeah. So now in that reason, I have to know that I have to deliver something to this moment. And so now that's why Jesus say, when you go to the secret place, you return in the power of the Spirit. And much more in the power of the Spirit, because even when I go in that secret place, I might go in, feeling heavy, wearing these weights, I'm worn in my mind, confused about this, confused about that. But now, once I go in that secret place, I come back as a different man. That's why Lord Jesus, thank you, Holy Spirit. I was wondering why I wore this shirt. Oh, thank you, Holy Ghost. And so now, and so now, that secret place is actually like the booth that Clark Kent went into. Yo, I cannot make this stuff up. And so now, you might go in the booth. You might go in the secret place. Ask Clark Kent. Yes, but when you come out, you come out like Jesus. But that's what happens when you go in the room, when you go in the secret place. You can go in the secret place as whatever your name is, but when you come out of that secret place, you got to come out of that secret place as Jesus. You can't come out as your best friend or as your mom and them. You got to come out as Jesus. He is the only way, the truth, and the life. So now if I need to live, I need to live like him. And so come on. Because I was about to put on a shirt that said freshness or something, but I was like, no, I'm going to keep on this shirt. And so I'm happy I kept on this shirt. See, we don't be knowing what stuff be for, but the Holy Spirit always got in mind what it's for. And so now when you go in that room, you come out as Jesus. And so now when you go out, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me.
Yes.
What's not working right in my house? The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. My marriage tripping? The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. My kids won't act right? The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. I got an addiction to alcohol or to sex? The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. So now, because when we try to handle things in our soul, we just can't get it done. No matter what, no matter the best strategies that we can get from people, no matter, you know, this person, you know, they was dealing with this, and so they said they did this, this, and that, so we try to do this, this, and that, and it don't seem like it worked out the same for us, because that was for them, not for you. So you cannot use somebody else's blueprint. If you don't use anybody's blueprint, use Jesus' blueprint, because he is the way, the truth, and the life. And so now, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And so I'm going to end right here. But I still got to read 91 songs. Like, I can't leave without reading that. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me. He. Because before, I was trying to do it on my own. But once I went into that secret place, I came out, I got anointed inside that secret place. I got filled up inside that secret place. That's why we go back and they got a scripture. He say, take courage. I am here. Because when I go in that room, I'm not there by myself. But he here with me. And so now, if I was discouraged about something, when I go in that room, when I go in that secret place, I come back and I take courage. When I go in there, I take the courage and I come out bringing that courage. So that's why I can walk out as a different man, because I'm not the same. There's something different about me, because there's something different on me. And so although the Spirit is the same, there's different anointings for different things. And so there might be something in your life that's different from something in your life. But that don't mean that there's not an anointing for your life and not an anointing for your life. There's a special anointing that God got for your life. But I can only get that anointing for what my life is in right now by going in that secret place. So once I go in, that's when I become anointed. To preach the gospel to the poor, he has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives and recovering the sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And he closed the book. He shut the door. And he gave it again to the minister. And then he sat down. Because once you go in that secret place, you're giving it all to God. You're dumping all your cares, you're casting all your cares on him. And so now, once you go in and you get that anointing, you can come out and you can rest, because you know that it's not you doing it, but it's him working through you. That's why Jesus said, it ain't me, it's the Father working through me. That's why I got to go in a secret place. I got to go to that solitary place, because I need him to work at full capacity through me. I got to get me out of the way. Let this cup pass from me, Father. But nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Let me get the hell out of the way so you can come through in this situation. And so the way that you get out of the way is in a secret place. And let God come through. And so then you can rest. He sat down. Stop pacing and worrying about what you're going through. Too many times we pacing and like, I don't know what the fuck, trying to figure this out, Lord. How about, oh, he's trying to do this, trying to do that. And so let me give you the cheat code. The cheat code is to stay in a secret place. Don't keep going in and out, but stay. I receive, remain. Abide in me as I abide in you.
Yes, sir.
Don't go nowhere else. Stay there. Even if you're somewhere else, always be knowledgeable that I'm in a secret place right now.
Yes.
Always stay in his presence.
Yes.
No matter if you're in the presence of anybody else, be aware that I'm in his presence right now.
Yes.
I'm in a position for him to be able to pour into me.
Yes.
Because my pot will produce my plenty. Or in the year 2020, my pot will produce my plenty, plenty. Because it's 2020, plenty, plenty. Plenty, plenty. And the eyes of all them. Because once you go in and get anointed, you become the message for whatever it is that you're going through. And so then people begin to look at you and marvel like, how? What in the world? Is that because, you know, people look at me, they're like, how are you able to do this? Like, they are, and so that's why you can ask me time and time again, I ain't gonna take no credit for nothing that I'm doing. Because let's turn to Romans 8. Romans 8, verse 26. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. The Spirit helps all of my weaknesses. He knows exactly where I'm weak at. But now I can be strong in my weakness when I know where to go. Because he covers my weaknesses with his strength. But it's when I can acknowledge where I'm weak at that he can be strong. When I try to put on a facade that I'm this strong and that I can handle this, I can't let him in. Even though I'm hurting, I'm trying to cover it up and act like ain't nothing wrong, he can't come in. Because I'm trying to handle it on my own. I'm trying to be strong without him. When I know that I'm weak there. And he know that I'm weak there. But he can't just come in where I'm weak at without my invitation. I got to invite him in where I'm weak at. So that's why, you know, you shouldn't have any problems with acknowledging your weaknesses, because in those moments is when that he could be the most strong. It's when we try to boast ourselves up as that we are greater than, that he can get no glory. Well, anybody ask me, God did it. He did it. He's the only way. There's no other way. Grace has covered me and has been with us, you know, throughout this journey, and it's going to continue being with us, because I'm going to give grace first place in my life. Can't nobody else have that place. Nobody. That's like, that place is solidified. Can't nobody come and even try to scratch. They got first place, and they got like spots 2 through 10 are all vacant, because first place filling up all that. So the best you could be is 11th. You can't even be second. You could be 11th, but you can't be second. Because I don't even want nobody getting that close to that number one spot. I can't let anything in my life be that close. Remember, there got to be a huge gap. And so now, the Holy Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray. I know what I'm going through, but I don't know what I need to pray to get me out of what I'm going through. But the Holy Spirit know. Because if I could pray, I'm going to say, Lord, get them, get her, get him, you know. You know. Hurt them like they hurt me. Let them feel what I'm feeling, you know. We pray all kind of ways. And so even in my weaknesses, even in me praying, you know, Father, let me take his place instead, I had to switch from that and start praying the Holy Ghost. Because that's an ignorant prayer. Even though it's a prayer that shows my care or my love, but it's ignorant. And I can't be praying for me to make God do something that I think ought to be done. Yes, sir. I got to trust in his sovereignty. I got to trust. So even though I don't understand what's going on, and I might not see it for some years of what's going on, or I might not see it for a day, I might see it for some days, some months, I still got to trust that it's his will. Whatever I'm in. So now when I know that it's his will, my perspective changes. And so now I don't think that I'm in a place without him, but I got to know that he's right there in the middle of the will. Because I'm there. So if I'm there, he there. Help our affirmative, for we not know prayers we ought, but the Spirit itself, himself, maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. That's why it's so remarkable, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, because we be up in here speaking all kind of languages that ain't none of us went to school for. We didn't take none of these classes. But I heard somebody pray another morning, boy, if it ain't sound like Asian, I don't know what Asian sound like. It sound like some kind of Chinese or Vietnamese or something, boy. But that person ain't gonna take no Vietnamese studies and learn no language like that. But the Holy Spirit maketh utterance that we don't know what the hell we saying. Or we don't know what the heaven we saying. We don't know what we saying. And that's the best way. Because if we understood what we were saying, we'd be like, oh, that's what it is. And then we go try to fix it. Instead of letting the Holy Spirit do what he got to do. And he that searches the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit. Because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. So no matter what your will is, praying in the Spirit is praying the perfect will of God. And once we do that, I come out of that secret place and I know that all things work together for my good. Whether this don't feel comfortable or whether I don't understand it, once I go in that secret place, I come out with full confidence. I come out anointed to know that everything is working out for my good because I love God. And because I love God, I can only love that because I know that he loved me. And so now let's go back to Luke chapter 4, verse 21. And he began to say unto them, this day. I want to release a this day anointing on you this morning. To where no matter which time you encounter something, you approach it with a this day. You go into that secret place and you come out anointed, knowing that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me for this day. Now faith is. I don't have to wait for tomorrow. This day. Why are you waiting for tomorrow? Tomorrow I ain't promising nobody. But oh, today. This day. Is the scripture fulfilled in your ears? So now when I go into that secret place, oh Lord, I don't know how. This day. Because this is a day that the Lord has made. So I'm going to be what?
Rejoice.
I'm going to do what?
Rejoice.
And do what?
Rejoice.
Unless I believe that this ain't his day. If it ain't his day, who day it is? So no matter what I'm going through, what's going on, whatever day it is, this day is his day. So if it's his day, his promise is going to be fulfilled. Yes. I'm going to have my peace. I'm going to have my protection. I'm going to have everything that the Father knows that I'm void of. Yes. Because I went in and I dumped it out and I showed him what those secret places were.
Yes.
So now when I go into secret places, there are no secret places in me because I'm revealing all those places to him.
Yes.
And so he sees those things and he's able to fill those empty places. So now there's, you know, a void, a misunderstanding, or there's I'm depleted, or there's a discrepancy somewhere. He can go in and he can touch that place. And so I want to tell you one other thing he told me. He said that he's going to turn your hurt into hiccups.
Yes, sir.
Because if you know anything about hiccups, they don't last that long. They're there for a moment. And you, but then all of a sudden, they gone. Some people say, hold your breath. Sound a whole lot like hold your peace to me. Hold your peace and let the Lord fight your battle. And he'll turn your hurt into a hiccup. To where it's there for a moment, but then before you even notice, you're not even hurting no more. It's gone. I remember I didn't have a hiccup. I know a lot of people here, you had hiccups sometimes, and you'd be hiccuping, and then you'd just be going, and all of a sudden you'd be like, hold up, I stopped hiccuping.
Yeah.
Hold up, I stopped hurting.
Yeah.
Hold up, I stopped being confused.
Yeah.
Hold up, I stopped being anxious.
Yeah.
Hold up, I stopped being depressed.
Yeah.
Hold up, I stopped being self-condemning.
Yeah.
Before I even knew it, he was able to handle it.
Yeah.
And so now, come on, let's read Psalms 91 together. I got to read this. Because I want your life to be a life in a secret place. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High, let's read together, shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flies by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth not at noonday. And 1,000 shall fall at thy side, 10,000 at thy right hand. But it shall not come nigh thee. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it ain't gonna touch me. This your song. It ain't gonna touch you. Come on, let's read. Keep reading. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the most, thy habitation. Thy habitation. That's where I live. The Most High is where I live. That's why I always live a high life, because I live in the Most High. Live in the Most High. Don't try to get high. Live in the Most High. Sometimes we try to get high to make our problems go away. We try to deal with it by getting high. Getting high ain't the answer. Living in the Most High. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For He shall give His angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and adder. The young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Because He has set His love upon me. Hold up right there. Hold up right there. Hold up right there. Hold up right there. Because He has set His love upon me. That's why when I go in that secret place, He dipped me in His love. To where I come out fully soaked. I come out of that secret place dripping. Yes. Dripping in His love. And so it becomes, so that's when favor becomes around me like a shield, because I'm dripping with love.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And so can't nothing come nigh what love is.
Amen.
Can't nothing take away from love. Can't nothing attack love. Can't nothing defeat love. Because love never fails.
Yes, sir.
Come on, because He has set His love upon me, therefore will I deliver Him. I will set Him on high because He has known my name. Hallelujah. He shall call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Hallelujah.
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 And so, I pray that the Holy Spirit has been able to answer any questions that you've had about anything in your life.
Amen.
No matter how hard it may be, no matter how uncomfortable or how confusing it may be, that you're able to rest in His peace, to rest in His love, to rest in Him. Make the Most High your habitation. Don't live nowhere else. Live in Him. And so once I stay there, I stay in the shadow of the Almighty.
Yes, sir.
And so for 18 years, Jesus was in the shadow of the Almighty.
Yes.
Couldn't nothing, not just 18 years, for all His life,
yes,
He was in the shadow of the Almighty. Because even on the cross, He was in the shadow of the Almighty. That's why nothing couldn't come nigh Him. That's why He said, you can't take my life.
Yes.
Even though they beat Him and bruised Him as bad as they could, spit on Him, they defied Him, humiliated Him as best they could. But still, could none of that kill Him. Because He stayed in that shadow. So as long as I stay in the shadow of the Almighty, under his feathers, under his wings, I could fly like an eagle. Because I'm flying under him. The Most High is my habitation. I'm living under him. And so where he goes, that's where I go. Where he shows, that's where I show. But I only stay where he is. Because that's the only place where peace is. That's the only place where healing is. You cannot keep carrying hurt. You can't. And one thing you can't do, you can't rehearse hurt. You cannot let your mind keep rehearsing it. You made a mistake, stop rehearsing it. It's over with. Jesus said, you done been with five, and the one you with now ain't your husband. But now, that don't matter. Don't keep going back to that. Go and sin no more. Let the life that's in you be the life that spring from you. So don't be rehearsing mistakes or stuff that didn't happen in your life. Things that you don't understand. Things that, you know, maybe something in your childhood that was traumatic to you. Don't keep rehearsing that thing over and over in your mind. Go in a secret place and dump that thing. Yes, sir. Forgive who need to be forgiven. That's why Jesus, he said, forgive them, Father, for they don't know what they do. Even though people might have done you something throughout your life, they didn't know what they was doing. But the Father knew that it was something building you into who you are today. That's why we can't try to substitute anything that has happened to us. Because it's the thing that made us who we are. You wouldn't be standing where you at now without going through what you went through. So I don't want to take nothing back, Lord. In the time I got whooped was taking a cologne. I don't want to take that back. Because that built me into who I am. Situation where I fell asleep at the wheel multiple times, driving on the way home. But he kept me. I don't want to take none of that back. Because I know that it's because he had his hand on me that ain't nothing happened to me. For me to be on the interstate in hydroplane, cross four lanes, and then go backwards into the woods, but the truck nestled so perfectly between two trees, and I get out without a scratch on my body, I don't want to take none of that kind of stuff away.
Yes, sir.
Because that's the kind of stuff that gives me hope and assurance and confidence in who he is.
Right, right.
And that no matter what I'm going through, he's always there with me. Because
yes,
I shouldn't have made it out of that.
Right.
But I got out of that without a scratch.
Yes, sir.
Like if I showed a picture of the SUV, you'd be like, God dang. And I went across four lanes of the highway. Down the side of it, into all the woods, and do you know, I drove by another day. I drive by all the time, but I saw it one day, and I looked over there because I wanted to just see where it was, and I saw a few feet over, there was a canal or a ravine going to a place that I could have dropped off really far, and I could have flipped over. It could have been really bad. But in the midst of that, he was like, hey, no, let's go right here. In the middle of these two trees. And then get out without a scratch on you. Yeah. I remember I got out and I was nervous because I had to, you know, call my father and let him know what I had and did.
Yeah.
And so that's why he expressed the true nature of God to me all the time.
Right, 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 right.
Because he said, I don't care nothing about the truck.
Yeah.
I just care about you.
Yeah.
I'm just happy that you're doing all right.
Yeah. Right.
I can get another truck. But as long as you find, whatever you're going, you can get another one of those.
Yes. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
The Father cares about you.
Yes.
He deeply cares about you. He knows you. He sees you. But you have to be able to see him.
Yes.
You have to be able to go to him and give him you to where that he can pour himself out into you. To where you go into that secret place as that empty water pot.
Yes.
And let him fill you up.
Yes.
Because once you get filled up, you know, you come out different. Because even, let's go back to Jesus. When he filled that water pot up, What he put in there ain't the same thing, ain't the same thing that came out. It came out different than what was put in. So when you go in, he puts something in you, but once you come out, it's going to come out different because we go through different situations. We got different experiences, and so it's going to come out different. But the same thing that's going in is him, his love, his spirit. And so let him fill you up with that, and you can face anything in life. I don't care what it is. Anything. Anything. You name it, because he done already defeated it all. And so now that's why my trust, my hope, my faith, my belief, my love got to be in him and what he did. Because I have to know that everything was won at Calvary. He knew what I'll be going through today. Back then. And so he was joyful back then because he knew that today, what I'm doing right now is going to take care of what they're going through today. So that day is every day. That's why I get up with a this day revelation. You know, I've been believing God for something? This day. I've been expecting to be healed? This day. I've been expecting for some prosperity demonstration to happen in my life? This day. I've been expecting to be whole? This day. That's my energy every day. This day. So now when I wake up, and my eyes open, and I get excited. I want to change your perspective. I get excited because I know that this is the day. Yesterday might not have went like I wanted to. But this day. What about tomorrow? I don't care about tomorrow. This day. Because all I got is this day. So what you gonna do this day? Choose you this day who ye will serve. Choose you this day who you will love. Choose you this day what you allow God to express through you. There's people that need to see your message. But you got to let God, you got to let God massage his message into you. Because he going to massage the hurt out, the bumps, the bruises, the nicks, the knacks. And his message is going to be able to flow through you. So let God massage you. I don't know about y'all, but when I get a massage, I ain't got a care in the world. I could have went in so tense, you know, so frustrated. But once I come out, I don't feel like doing nothing but chilling. But that's the kind of rest that he want to give you. To where you go in that secret place and let him massage on you. Let him rub out those knots that weight you've been carrying on your shoulder. Let him rub it out. Let him massage that out of you. And then he'll massage his message in you, all right? Give God a hand of praise.
Well, there you have it. You know, aside from the many prayers that I receive, me and my family from a lot of people, you know, praying for our strength, you know, over the past year and a half, it's being able to stay and hide in the secret place. And so the secret place is my favorite place. And so the cheat code is to, you know, never leave the secret place, to stay there. And so you get everything in life there. You get your protection, your provision, you know, your peace. The presence is there. Like everything that you could ever desire is right there in the secret place. So carry the secret place with you, you know, everywhere you go. And so there's one thing that I want you to take away, you know, from this message is really understanding how much God loves you. And God, he's there with you. He sees you. He knows you. He cares about you. Doesn't matter what it is that comes up in this life here on earth, we have to understand the bigger picture. And so there's a statement that was made that I made during this message saying that I'm not going to preach a gospel of Kobe Bryant, not knowing the unfortunate events that will follow that message or what was happening during that message. But it was to compare that no matter who we love, no matter what we esteem or who we esteem, we cannot esteem or love anybody more than we love Christ. Like Christ is the one who came and he paved the way. Like he lived his life. He laid his life on the line. He rose again for us to show us that we have victory in this life. We have dominion in this life and in the next life. And so we have to understand, like, eternal life isn't something that starts after we transition or after life on earth ends. Like eternal life, it doesn't end. Like we keep going. And so no matter who we love, no matter what we esteem or who we esteem, we cannot esteem or love anybody more than we love Christ. Like Christ is the one who came and he paved the way. Like he lived his life. He laid his life on the line. He rose again for us to show us that we have victory in this life. We have dominion in this life and in the next life. And so we have to understand, like, eternal life isn't something that starts after we transition or after life on earth ends. Like eternal life, it doesn't end. Like we keep going. And so we can only have assurance in that through him. And so no matter who it is, you know, I've gained a lot of wisdom and knowledge, you know, from my father, from Dr. Phil, and from other people, but I have to understand who Christ is. And so once I understand who Christ is, everything else gets real clear. And I can live life and I can stand and I can strong and I can be built up to be able to handle anything. Romans 8:28 is, you know, a scripture, a verse that's imprinted on my heart forever, because once you know how much God loves you and you reciprocate that same love, you love him with everything in you, all your mind, all your soul, all your strength, all your will, then you understand that even if things don't seem right or they don't seem fair or, you know, just don't seem comfortable, like, I know that everything gotta work out for my good, regardless of if I understand it or not, or if I feel like, you know, this shouldn't happen to me or whatever, whatever. It did happen to you. You are where you are. The situation is what it is. And so now, from here, from that moment, where do you go? What do you do? So once I understand how much he loves me and I love him back that same way, I know everything gotta work out for my good. It has to. Ain't got no choice, because how much he loves me. Even if things were fixed or set up a way to where it wasn't gonna work out for me, because he loved me, some things would get rearranged to work out for me. That's just how it is. You gotta know that more than anything. And so, yeah, it might hurt. Yeah, it might be uncomfortable. But he said he'll turn your hurt to hiccups. They'll be gone. And so his love does that. And so I'm thankful for that, man. And so I thank God for Jesus. I thank God for the Spirit. I thank God for life, man. And so thank God for loving me. I thank you for, you know, being one with me, making me one with him, to where I can do things that I didn't think that I could do. Like, there was no way that I thought that I could be here, you know, pastoring or ministering or leading people in any kind of capacity. I was always wanted to be, you know, to the back, you know, in the background, you know, not on the scene. Like, I just want to be undercover. Like, I don't want to be seen. I just kind of want to help, but, you know, be out of the way. But I never thought I'd be able to do anything like this, especially not, you know, at this time, maybe, you know, 20, 25 years from now, but, you know, not now. But it's only by the grace of God. It's only by God's love for me and my understanding of how much he loves me and my love for him. My life is dedicated to him. It's totally living for him. I want his will fulfilled. I want his kingdom fulfilled. I want the desires of his heart to be fulfilled in me and in this life. And so that's what life is, man. And so thank you for watching. Share this with somebody. Share this with Vanessa Bryant. Share this with the Bryant family. Share this with anybody that you know who've experienced, you know, the transition of a loved one, and they having a difficult time understanding how God sees them and what he thinks about their situation, their case. He got love for them all.